So here we are at the Black Country Radio Studios, ready to interview Beverley Nielsen, the Liberal Democrat West Midlands mayoral candidate for the West Midlands mayoral elections for 2017. Follow us on the hashtag WMLX17. Let's go and see what she has to say. Hello, so here we are at the Black Country Radio Studio with Beverley Nielsen, the Liberal Democrat candidate for the West Midlands mayoral elections for hashtag WMLX17. So I've got our set questions and then some questions from the general public as well.
Hi, so, Connor.
Thank you. So my first question to you is, tell us about your background and why politics?
Okay, well, I'm not a career politician and I have had a very short period as a councillor in Worcestershire, but actually, apart from that, I haven't got any political experience. I have worked for 20 years, lived and worked for 20 years in the West Midlands. And in that time, I've done a number of roles in campaigning and lobbying for the Confederation of British Industry and the Heart of England Tourist Board. I've worked as a director of a FTSE 250 business, Arga Range Master, and I've been a managing director of a business called Fired Earth. And for the last 10 years, I've worked in higher education as a director for Birmingham City University, and I'm a fellow at Warwick Manufacturing Group at the University of Warwick. But in all that time, when I started to think about this position that we're in with devolution and the mayoral role, I started looking back and thinking, what investment has this region had? You know, how much money has actually been invested in here over that time? And it occurred to me we'd been a bit of a flyover state, you know, like a middle child caught between London and the southeast and the north, really. And we had not had our fair share. When I looked at the numbers, we'd actually had under 20% investment per head in transport here compared to London and the South East. Yet, we move 80% of the rail freight and 30% of the road freight, and we're right in the heart of the country as the manufacturing heartland. And that just didn't seem right. So I thought to myself, well, how come we haven't had our fair share? You know, who's going to stand up for us? Who's going to make sure that we do get what we deserve and what we need? And if this country is serious about rebalancing our economy following the financial crash, which people in politics have been talking about for some time, but which we haven't achieved, then somebody needs to speak up for this region. So I thought to myself, look, I really want to do something about this. I want to be part of it, and I want to make sure that we have a champion for change and that we have somebody who's able to pull the region together and represent the views of this great region that has transformed the world so many times in the past and is actually at this amazing point in time right now where we could transform the world again and lead the next industrial revolution. So that's why I put my name forward.
Brilliant. So you talked a little bit about it, but I'm going to ask the question anyway. So what's your connection with the West Midlands?
Yeah, well, I have lived and worked here for 20 years, for the last 20 years, but I also was born here a little bit sometime prior to that, Connor. And but I came back here because it was coming home. I actually grew up in Ireland because my father, we left in the 60s, and actually I had a chance when I became director of the CBI West Midlands to come back home for me, and I really wanted to do that, and I'd always had that thought that I might be able to come back home in mind, and then things worked out that way and I was able to do that. But this place has given me so many opportunities. I've raised my family here, I've got three children, and I've had a fantastic career here, and I've met so many amazing people, and I've seen so many incredible things that we're achieving here, and I've tried to promote the region through all sorts of initiatives like West Midlands First and Midlands Excellence and Birmingham Made Me, and I've tried to promote the great brands of the region, and I feel passionately about it, and I feel that we've been overlooked and our achievements over the centuries have not been recognised or appreciated, and so I really want to do something about putting that right, and I want to make sure that we get the investment that we need, especially now as we look forward to the transformation happening in terms of energy, in terms of the way we're moving in the future with electric vehicles and autonomous vehicles, driverless cars, and the way we're going to store energy in future. And all of these innovations are happening here, but they need investment and they need a long-term perspective, and the public and private sectors need to work together so that we can really capitalise on what lies in front of us.
Brilliant. So a little bit of less of a serious question, but not at all less important. So what's your favourite local culinary delicacy?
Well, I do enjoy a good Balti, and I do like to go out, and it's always great fun, isn't it? I mean, this, to be honest, this is a difficult question, isn't it? Because there's so much, actually, so many great places to eat right across the whole region. So I think I'll probably stick with the Balti for today. But I do know that I've been hearing that faggot and peas is the answer I should be giving in the Black Country.
As you may or may not know, I'm 17. So in this election, I will not be able to vote for any candidate as it stands currently. So how will you ensure that young people's issues are fairly represented?
Well, for me, they're absolutely top of my agenda in my campaign. I've been focusing on investing in young people as they are what I regard as the human goldmine for the future that's going to power growth. Your creativity, your energy, your insights and innovations is what's going to transform our economy and lead the future for this region. We have the highest proportion of students in this region, but we're not sort of seen as a Cambridge or an Oxford. In fact, our reputation isn't really where it needs to be as a region. So I want to put you as young people at the heart of my agenda. And as a result of that, I'm sort of offering free transport for young people 16 to 25. I'm offering bursaries for young people who are working with small and medium-sized businesses in the area, with manufacturing companies, or looking to start up their own, you know, micro businesses, startups, because what we really need is to get a great deal more energy into the entrepreneurship and startups right across the region. And we need to stop the brain drain, because we've got too many young people studying here, you know, at the many great universities and colleges across the region, and then just leaving when they've finished. And actually, there's a lot of research to show that the more you can keep graduates and people who finish their studies in a region, the greater your opportunities for success as a region are.
So, with our local authorities struggling to keep up with the financial demand of social care, does that mean that youth services will see further cuts?
I think it's really shocking what's happened with the cuts that we've seen over the last 5 years in particular. We've seen over 50% cuts in, for example, adult education. And I know from talking with all sorts of youth community services, whether it's in the Black Country and Wolverhampton or in Coventry, that we've seen a lot of community centres closed. And I do think that we have a risk of further closures. In fact, you may not be aware of it, but actually, alongside the devolution deal, which is looking to bring in, you know, around 8 billion over the next 30 years, we've actually got a further 4 billion of cuts to public service finances by 2020, really seriously large cuts coming our way. And then we move to a new system of collecting money for the region, for the public services in the region, through a business rates retention system. We don't really know how this is going to work, but we don't know how this is going to work. So I think there are threats, and I think what this is going to require is we've got to be really thinking about how we can become more independent as a region, how we can create new revenue streams of our own to look after those who are most vulnerable, who need the greatest protection. And I think we have to look at the assets that we've got in the region and how we draw on those again to create a base that will offer opportunity for people in the young people, vulnerable people across the region. So I do think it's an area of concern, and I think that the mayor really needs to lead here and fight for our fair share, which we haven't had. You know, we haven't had it in public sector, we haven't had it in education, we haven't had it in transport, and I think it's quite shocking that the main parties are not making sure that we get our fair share at the moment, and that we really need everybody, the people out there, to be aware of what's happening.
So you talked a little bit about that, but how would you, as the West Midlands Mayor, help to protect young people's services and youth services in particular?
Yeah, well, I think that we've got to sort of look at how we're investing in those services, but I do also think that one of the things that I've been quite interested in is how can we get those community leaders in already out there in the community, really know young people, working with young people. I've met quite a few of them in different areas of the region. How can we get them to set up perhaps community enterprises and maybe do some short-term asset transfers, you know, that give some assets and some ownership to the places where young people can gather, and then I think really make sure that we've got a revenue stream going in there. But I think there's just a lack of foresight in our planning in these areas. So we need a longer term plan, we need to harness the communities, and then we might need to look at some devices like an asset transfer on a relatively short term basis so that young people have got the space where they can gather and keep engaging in activities and learning and doing embarking on future relationships with people who are going to be working with and growing with in the future.
So, do you feel that young people are educated enough in politics in regards to who or what they are actually voting for?
Well, I think this is a really interesting point because I think that actually they could do with more education around politics, because actually what, you know, I meet a lot of young people and say, oh, it doesn't really concern me, you know, it's not something that I have a view about or that I'm engaged with at the moment. But actually it is. And so if we take the Brexit vote, and 70% of young people actually voted to remain in the EU, but actually there were a lot of, if we'd had young people voting from 16, for example, that might have been an even higher proportion. So I think it is important that young people are engaged in politics. It is important that we hear your voice. And given that the future rests with you, I'd like to see that voice very well represented and taken into account in, you know, really seriously. So yes, I think it's important.
So would you support teaching politics to some degree in West Midlands schools?
Well, I think the curriculum is always quite full. Yes, if we can fit it into the curriculum in a way that makes sense for schools, then yes, I think so. But also, I do think it's really important that young people are thinking about what's going on in society, are questioning all the time, are challenging things, not accepting things just because they're the status quo, thinking about how we can do things better, and talking, you know, and engaging all the time with the structures that are there, because there are structures there, and if you are engaging with them, which I understand, you know, you have done yourself, Connor, in the past, you were telling me about going down to the House of Commons and speaking there. Well, I think that's great, isn't it? You know, and really broadens your perspective on how this process of governance in this country actually works.
So what makes us different to other parts of the UK?
Here? Well, we're a great manufacturing heartland. We've changed the world not only once, but so far to date, three times. You know, we've led three industrial revolutions. We launched the first industrial revolution very much here in the Black Country in Birmingham and in Telford, where Abraham Darby first smelted iron ore with coke. That process powered and fueled the industrial revolution and meant that we had steam, you know, and power. So then from there, we then had mass production and satellite communications, which was pretty much invented not far from here. We invented radar. We invented the liquid crystal display. I don't know whether you're aware of that, but so the whole communications revolution started here in the West Midlands. And now we're on the cusp of this revolution in terms of how we move artificial intelligence and how everything becomes connected up together, whether we're moving in driverless vehicles, which are taking, storing energy, transferring it to the home, and the devices that we bring around with us all the time are, you know, telling us how we can most effectively store or create energy for the future. So I think that is actually happening. 1 million electric vehicles were sold last year worldwide. Jaguar Land Rover investing $650 million into electric vehicle production here in the West Midlands. Obviously, we've got the I-54 plant in Wolverhampton. We need to really invest very seriously in this opportunity, because by 2020, 20 million cars, electric vehicles, are due to be sold, and by 2030, 100 million vehicles. So investing in this opportunity for the future will create jobs for young people, whether it's in production, in connectivity, the digital elements, you know, as these devices are going to link up with our cars, with our homes. There'll be jobs in construction, because we need to double the houses that we're building in the region. There'll be jobs in energy and battery storage, where we're leading. We've got an energy research accelerator in Warwick, just down the road. We've got manufacturing technology centres. So I think this region is going to transform the world again, but it needs a long-term vision. I think we need to start with the end in mind and work backwards and then invest. And if we were to do what Silicon Valley has done on the other side of the world here, then why not be, we could become the greatest region, not only in the UK, not only in Europe, but really in the world, and transform the world again.
So places like Birmingham used to be called the workshop of the world, a city of 1,000 trades, but trade is changing and so are jobs that we young people are really struggling to get. So what do you plan to do to make sure that there are enough high value jobs to keep us in the region?
Well, I think I've just sort of been talking about that, Connor. I mean, I think it, in terms of really the opportunity to link the research that's going on in some of our universities and the research centres and institutions into the market opportunities which are opening up right in front of our eyes. I've talked about electric vehicles, I've talked about battery storage, energy storage, battery power, but also we've got life sciences and our tremendous leadership in places like Queen Elizabeth Hospitals in Birmingham and in other hospitals across the region, and again hooking up that network and into our universities is very important. I think construction is another opportunity, because we do need to double the number of homes that we're building in the region. We need more affordable homes, especially for young people. But I think that in doing that, we need to think that homes are very different in future. They're going to be utterly connected. So the device that, you know, we all carry around with us are going to be connected into our homes and are going to be telling us, you know, when we need another bottle of milk or a loaf of bread, or when we need to maybe eat food that's better for us, you know, if we're missing some deficiencies in the food that we're eating. And so I think that all of this needs to be connected into the learning and the education system, and we need to make sure that not only are we driving the research programs that are going to drive the high value added activities that will create the jobs in the future, but also that the young people in schools from primary age are going to be connected into those opportunities too, and get decent, you know, really top quality mm-hmm. careers advice, good work experience. Because when I go into the colleges and talk to young people, and they say to me, oh, but I, you know, they've had maybe one bit of work experience, but I think they need to, from a very early age, be aware of what business opportunities are opening up, what experience they need alongside their formal studies, what employability skills would help them, you know, the sort of communication skills, all of that sort of thing. So I think there's quite a lot to be done in terms of young people being more aware of what opportunities there are going to be in this region, so that they won't be looking necessarily down to the southeast, but will be aware that right here on their doorstep there are going to be some really great high value added jobs of the sort that you've just been asking me about.
So good or bad, how do you think Brexit is going to affect young people living in the West Midlands, and how are you going to maximise those opportunities? It says in my notes, please avoid the clichés. It wouldn't be 2017 without a question about Brexit, so we'll go ahead with that one.
Yeah, well, clearly, I personally voted to remain. I'm, you know, sorry that the country is leaving the EU, but I do accept the decision has been taken through the referendum and we are moving towards an exit. Given that, I think that we have to protect the livelihoods and jobs of the people of this region, who depend very much on being able to export to that market in the easiest possible way. And, you know, 42% of our exports go to the EU. It's about £12 billion of goods and services destined for that market each year. We have to make sure that we can have the greatest ease of access for those exports to the EU market. So really, my concern at the moment is around a hard Brexit. I'm very concerned that that's the way we seem to be heading according to the government. I would like to see another say on the deal when we finally have a deal with Europe. And I think, you know, that if that is going to take another couple of years, and it may be that that happens through an election. But I think at some point we need to agree that this is the deal that we all want as a country.
So it's no secret that young people are disenfranchised with politics. Do you blame them?
I think that, you know, I can understand why people would be disenfranchised with politics, and I do think there is a great cry from the heart for reform at the moment, you know, because of what we've been through. I think globalisation has left many communities feeling that, sort of in a way, the heart's been ripped out of them. And of course, global capitalism, it feels to me a little bit like a trawler net, you know, that sort of sweeps through communities and takes the money out of those communities and then sort of dumps it somewhere else, maybe a long way away. And through global capitalism, we have exported jobs, you know, industrial jobs, we've exported skills, and frankly, we've exported pollution, because we've sort of said it's okay for the Chinese to sort of spew out lots of CO2 emissions, but we've regulated CO2 emissions, for example, here. And I think that's you know, something we need to really think seriously about. Is that how we want to run things ourselves? Or would it be better, for example, to invest more in industrial jobs here and actually have jobs for people here rather than spend money on benefits for people who are unemployed in post-industrial areas? So I think I can understand how people have are calling for reform, looking at how we've been running the economy and aren't entirely persuaded by it. But if you want change, then I think, you know, you've got to get engaged at that point. And I'm sort of saying to people, if you're happy with the way things are now, if you're happy with the way we've run our economy, then, you know, fine, you know, sit back, do nothing, or don't vote. But if you really want change, if you want an entrepreneurial state that's going to invest in you as the young people and have a long-term plan in mind and work towards the vision that that long-term plan paints, then vote for change, you know. And as a Lib Dem mayoral candidate, I'm saying, I'm putting you, young people, at the heart of my plan. I'm concerned that, you know, you voted to stay in the EU, you saw your future there by and large, and, you know, it's going to be a route that requires some further negotiation for us to be clear about what that route looks like. And I want to support young people. I want you to have the best possible future. I want to work with you, your energy, your talent, your skills, to make sure that together we can get to an agreed vision, a place that's somewhere a lot better than where we are now. And I want us to work in the public sector and in the private sector creatively to find entrepreneurial ways of investing in our communities, in our young people, and in our future. And if that's what you want, then I would appeal to you to vote Lib Dem.
So I'm just going to read, I've got three questions that we've been sent from Civify social media.
Yeah.
So the first one is from Lennon from Aldridge. So with the Lib Dem party mantra being sliding to the Remainers, how do you plan to win over young Leave voters like me?
All right, well, really good to hear that question. I think the big opportunity that Brexit does pose for us is this reform, you know, that we weren't, I think socialism has failed us because we collected taxes and then redistributed taxes, but we didn't create the jobs. Global capitalism has failed communities because it hasn't enabled us to regenerate communities. It's actually sort of stripped money out of places and sent it internationally somewhere else. And we've had a tremendous focus on inward investment, you know, pulling investment in from overseas, which is often just stays for a short while and then goes away again. What I'm saying to people is, let's invest in our community and be entrepreneurial here, invest in our small businesses, encourage micro startups, and give people here the hope for the future. And I think what Brexit is it sort of shakes us up a bit, and it says, let's try new models now. So I would say to your questioner, let's try this new way of actually valuing our people, valuing our communities, and going back to a form of liberalism of the 1900s, of something that was very, it was a sort of a liberal model that was place-based. You know, looking at our place and investing in our people, and that's what I'm proposing.
Claire from Coventry asks, how do you see the Liberal Democrats changing in the next 10 years?
Well, I think the Liberal Democrats are the party that is really always focused on the local place, and that's what I've, you know, just been trying to talk about. I think we are a party that looks to engage with communities, look after communities, and look after the most vulnerable in those communities, but at the same time look to create the wealth that we need to be sustainable and to have an inclusive future for everybody. So I think for me, I look at the parties to the left wing, the left of the spectrum at the moment, and I think that they're missing the middle ground, you know. And the Liberal Democrats can be in that middle ground and work with young people and help to ensure that we have a positive future that is inclusive but is equally entrepreneurial. But it's a sort of inclusive entrepreneurialism that will give as many people as possible a really good future. That's the space that we're in at the moment. So I hope that answers Claire's question.
Okay, so final question from the public is Rihanna from Sedgley. So how will you strengthen transport links for young people from places such as Dudley?
Yeah, I think it's Rihanna, it's really important to do that. And actually, as I say, I'm offering free transport for young people 16 to 25. But of course, that's so that young people really get, you know, are able to move around for work, to study, to be able, you know, just for leisure purposes, so able to get out and about. But it's also to get that habit going early, so that perhaps people don't buy a first car, and then we can improve air quality, and we can invest more in real choices on public transport, whether it's bus, tram, train, that you really can move around this region by public transport, best public transport, quality public transport offer in the UK, rather than simply having to buy a car, which is pretty much the situation at the moment.
Let me find my last question. That's great. I'm sure they'll appreciate your responses. My final question is, finally, why should people who are eligible to vote for you?
Well, I hope that people will vote for me, because I've lived and worked in this region for 20 years in a wide range of areas. I really understand the region. I've worked in manufacturing. I've run Fired Earth as a managing director. I've worked in education, and I've worked in campaigning and lobbying, and I've worked in the public and the private sector. I've been a councillor. I've even taken a failing part of the activities of a council out of the council into a social enterprise and transformed that activity to a very successful social enterprise that has been able to reinvest all of the profits or the surpluses that we've made back into the young people that we're supporting. So I've had the breadth of experience, but one other thing that I think is important to think about this role, the mayoral role, will chair the board of the combined authority, and that board is made up of 6 Labour leaders and 1 Conservative leader. And I think if you vote for a Labour mayor and get a Labour mayor, nothing will change. You'll get the same that you've seen in this region for the last 20 years. And I think if you vote for a Conservative mayor, then the Labour leaders will resist change and nothing will happen. And I think if you vote for somebody like me, a Lib Dem mayor, then you will get as close to an independent mayor as this region could have. And I will work with all parties on a cross-party consensus for a long-term plan to protect the interests of our people, all our people, to deliver an inclusive growth model, and in particular, to put young people at the heart of that. So that's why I believe you should vote for me.
Thank you very much. So that was Beverley Nielsen, the Liberal Democrat West Midlands mayoral candidate for the hashtag WMLX17. Let us know what you think. Was that a good interview, a bad interview? Was there anything that you liked or didn't like about what she said and her opinions? Let us know again at hashtag WMLX17, or you can get in contact with us on civify.org.